Hello, my name is Dustin Demontigny, and my video is to talk to you about human factors and why they're important in medical device development. I have a degree in electrical engineering. I have 16 years of experience in product development, including electronics hardware, firmware, software, and system engineering. I transitioned from design to project management, and I'm now a project manager at StarFish Medical, developing medical devices. And through my work at StarFish Medical, I've come to understand the value and importance of human factors in product development, and especially medical devices. So what are human factors? Human factors, as a definition, is a scientific study that evaluates the understanding human interactions in relation to other elements of a system. Human factors engineering permits the product to assess and mitigate risks associated with the correct use and use errors of a product. This is very important. There is no such thing as user errors. If you've ever been frustrated with a device or piece of equipment, it's probably not your fault. It's probably because human factors weren't properly incorporated into the design of that product. And so that's a very important considerations for our human factors teams, as well as the product development team. And because human factors isn't always a priority, that's really the message I want to convey to you, is it's should always become part of the development process from start to finish, and incorporating processes into that makes it easier to use and follow. So why is it we care about human factors in medical devices? So first one, safety. Safety is already the first priority. And so human factors ensures that the devices we are developing are safe for use by patients and users in general. The other reason is regulatory requirements. In medical devices require regulatory approval before they can be marketed and sold. And so without that, without human factors, you won't be able to pass your regulatory approvals. And then the third one is just makes good business sense. Making devices easier and familiar and intuitive for users just makes sense, because then your adoption and market will grow. So I just wanted to share with you some examples of human factors gone terribly wrong. So one of the best ones I could find was the Kegworth air disaster. This is an example where a commercial flight was taking off, and they had a motor fan blade failure. And the first officer and pilot reacted very quickly, and they went to cancel the air to the failed engine. And the problem was, the new model of the plane had the controls for the engines reversed. So they actually cut off the air to the functioning engine and ramped up the throttle on the broken engine, and that actually ended up causing a fire and causing the plane to crash. And so this is called negative transfer, where the pilot and first officer were very familiar with previous versions of the plane, but those interfaces were swapped, and when they swapped, it caused the malfunction to become much worse. A similar example, but more related to medical devices, is there was a surgical table that had a really nice interface for the surgical team to adjust the pitch of the table. And they liked that so much that a newer version of that table used that same interface to allow the table to be flipped over during the cleaning process. Well, the problem with that obviously is then the surgeon and the surgical team who are familiar with this to make adjustments, they went to make an adjustment to the table and the whole table flipped over and the patient ended up on the floor. That's a terrible, terrible occurrence, and it happened because something that was familiar to the user was completely changed in terms of its use. A fairly dated but really common example that I could think of for really bad human factors and usability is VCR clocks. So in the old days, most people's VCR clocks were just blinking noon or 12, and the reason was they were so annoying to set that people just left them in their default state. And again, this speaks to my good business practice. If you make a product that's really frustrating to use, people aren't going to use it in the first place. And when this applies to medical devices, if users like the nurses and clinicians don't want to use your device, then even if your device is really effective, it's not going to apply to patients, and the standard of care is not going to be improved. I also want to give you examples of human factors done really well. And the best example I can think of, although not a medical device, is the Apple iPhone. So the Apple iPhone interface was so intuitive that it it basically changed what we know of in terms of most user interfaces. And my experience with that was I handed my iPhone to my 2-year-old son, and without any direction or instruction, he was able to pick it up and interact with it. And that was the moment when I realized how effective that user interface was. Another example related more to safety is I heard a story about Apple, and they developed the magnetic charging cable. And so I think Steve Jobs was in a meeting, and he saw somebody trip over a charging cable of a laptop that was sitting on the desk. And he saw that, and he said, we can't have that happen. So they developed this magnetic connection so that if somebody kicks the charging cable, it will come out and disconnect, and the person won't trip, and the equipment won't go flying and get damaged. So it sort of solved two problems. It reduced the chances of harm to the users and any passerby, and it also reduced the damage of the equipment in a fairly standard system. Third example I want to give for human factors done really well is automated external defibrillators, also known as AEDs. Anybody who's been trained in CPR will know that there's a fairly regimented process to perform CPR. And what these AEDs allow users to do is not only do they provide the defibrillation that you wouldn't be able to do on your own, but they provide you a verbal step-by-step instructions on what to do and in what order. So in an emergency situation, it allows the users to just focus on the instructions given by the AED device, and it allows them to perform the emergency care needed in a much more effective and orderly manner. And I think that was a really good human factors development specific to a very critical emergency need. So I've mentioned it, but just to clarify, human factors affects who? It affects the patients, but also all the users. Like I mentioned, nurses, clinicians, everybody involved in healthcare and treatment of patients. But then it also affects other users that you might not think about. So the people that manufacture the devices, the people that are required to ship, store, and maintain the devices, they are also included because they interact with the medical device. So it's important to consider those in addition to your standard patients and health users. So as I mentioned before, when does human factors take place? It needs to start at the very beginning of product development and needs to continue throughout that cycle. It should never end, because it needs to be maintained until the product is deemed to be complete and ready to go into the marketplace. So some processes involved in doing human factors during product development. First one would be a site visit. So often when you're developing a medical device, you want to observe what the current standard of care or related standard of care is. And so you want to go and take video, ask questions, observe whatever is normal or related to the standard of care. And I'll never forget, we had a client who it was a dental application, and the client was kind of confused. You know, they said, why would you want to come and measure and observe my standard dental room when you've probably had many dental procedures? You should know what we do here. But the key is that we're coming in with fresh eyes. We're observing people doing their job in space, and we're assessing the workflow. And by doing so, we're able to assess and understand things that may not be readily understood or important from a clinical perspective, but from a product development perspective is really important. Once you have your site visit, you probably want to conceptualize or develop your workflow. So how your device is going to be interacting with all the different users and spaces. And once you have your workflow, you'll want to test or evaluate that workflow in some sort of formative evaluation. So you want to engage with potential users and sort of understand if your proposed workflow is going to fit. Again, I talked about negative transfer. The idea there is you don't want to go against what is currently being done. And even better, you want to minimally impact the current standards of care workflows. And so an example I have is the complexity and refinement of your equipment when you do these formative evaluations doesn't have to be very high. So we developed a cart-based system, and we developed a concept simply using wood plywood. And the client was a little confused because, you know, in this case, it was surgeons, and the surgeons were saying, what could you possibly discover by bringing us a box of wood? Well, we had conceptualized the product and brought it to their site, and we invited a number of different users that would be interacting with the device. And it was a good thing we did that, because it allowed us to develop a workflow that was really ideal for this potential device that we would never have been able to come up with without the input and feedback from that team. And so it was a very useful example, and they were definitely appreciative of that process once we finished. Once you do your formative evaluations, you're sort of nearing the middle end of your product development cycle, and that's when you get into some detailed work like labeling and defining your training materials. So you have user manuals, training aids, maybe a quick reference guide or a video. And that's really important from a regulatory perspective, and it's really important from a human factors perspective, because that's what we use to ensure that that users that are not familiar with the new product are able to use it in a safe and effective and intuitive manner. So then we move into formative testing, where we confirm that everything we've planned is as intended, and it matches. And usually there you have some findings, and that's okay, because the formative testing is your last step to get it right. Any changes that you do to your workflow or your labeling and training guides needs to be tested using your formative testing process, because once you get to summative testing, that's your last chance. That's basically you proving that you've done everything effectively. And any changes that take place to your workflow or supporting material needs to go through a formative testing process. And a good example I have of that is sometimes this is challenging, because in your product development cycle, there's parallel processes. So we were developing our labeling and training tools in parallel to doing cleaning validation. And what happened is, after cleaning validation, we needed to make adjustments based on the test results. So we had to actually change and expand the cleaning process, and we never carried that through our formative testing. So once we got to summative testing, it was so interesting, because the only use errors we discovered during summative testing were related to the expanded cleaning procedure. So it sort of confirmed the fact that had we gone through a formative testing, we probably would have caught it and would have yielded far less use errors during summative testing. That's the end of my presentation. I hope you had a better understanding of human factors and how important they are during medical device development. What I would like you to take away from this presentation are that human factors are an important part of any medical device development for safety, regulatory, and good business reasons. Human factors need to be considered at the very beginning of a medical device development and continuously from beginning to end throughout the design process. Human factors affects anybody interacting with medical device, including patients, users, and other people involved in the medical device use. My name is Dustin Demontigny, and I hope you enjoyed this presentation. You can reach me at info@starfishmedical.com if you have any questions or feedback.